In this episode, Sean Perry is going to tell us about his career in the Fire and Rescue Service. He's also travelled around the world extensively, and he's going to tell us some of the stories and life lessons that he's learned along the way. Also, our podcast sponsor is the European Hemp Company. Listeners of this podcast can get £10 off and free shipping on CBD oil. Just use code BenLarryPodcast at checkout. Also, if you'd like to be a guest on this podcast, go to benlarry.com/podcastguest. If you'd like to be a sponsor, go to benlarry.com/sponsorship. Also, I'm part of a property investing joint venture group, which is based in South Wales and is led and coached by a teacher called Alex Louise Brown. And if you'd like to find out more information about that, go to financialfreedomfilms.com. Hello, Sean. How are you doing today?
I'm good. Thank you very much. How are you?
Yeah, well, thanks for coming on the podcast. I know it's been a while since we've caught up, and I know a little bit about you. I know you're a fireman. You've worked in the fire service for a long time, and I know you've had all kinds of other interesting experiences in life as well, but I don't really know much detail, really. So do you want to sort of summarise yourself a little bit?
Wow, that's a difficult one. Yeah, so I'm 47. I work for the fire service. I've worked for the fire service for about 16 years now. And I do have lots of interests outside of the fire service. But yeah, I'm non-operational at the moment because I work in the support side now. Still uniformed staff, but I support operational firefighters by developing new systems that make their lives easier and also make the public safer. Just streamlining workflows for them and collating and disseminating information out to the service. To keep people more informed and safer in the public. So on day to day outside of work, I enjoy upcycling things, 1920s lighting, putting it back to new and then giving it to a new owner, you know.
Really?
Yeah, so but all sorts of stuff. You know, I've always trained hard, worked out, done a lot of running, done a lot of gym stuff. I ran the London Marathon a couple of years ago, which was absolutely incredible. One of the highlights of my life, really. That was a really big thing to do, and determined to do it, and got through there with a good time. But yeah, I've always been in gyms all my life, and seen that as an important part of me as an individual, you know, keeping upbeat and all sorts of interests, really.
Have you done a lot of traveling?
I have traveled extensively around the world. Japan, China, Australia, America. Yeah, so I see traveling for me as one of the best things about I guess getting to grips with yourself and understanding the planet and the people that live on it. I think I recommend traveling to anybody. It breaks down all prejudices, anybody that travels to lots of different countries, it makes them a better person. They see the world and through different eyes. And I normally see people who have prejudices are the ones that are closed off to the rest of the world and just don't see that we live on a planet full of so many different diverse cultures, and that diversity is something to be celebrated and to enjoy and experience and see the wonders of difference, and being different is a good thing, you know, and I think mostly those people that do travel see that, and the ones that don't are generally the ones that are come at things from an angle of fear because they haven't experienced those things and haven't enjoyed the difference in people. So traveling is fantastic. I've always traveled.
What kind of experiences do you look for when you go somewhere? Like, is there certain kinds of places you like to go? Do you enjoy like the nature and the geography and stuff, or like what kind of places do you gravitate to in a new country?
Do you know, a bit of everything, but mainly where the indigenous people are, so that you get a good understanding of them. I normally try to go to religious temples to get a spiritual sort of feeling about the place. So my for instance, travel to Cambodia, first stop was Angkor Wat. I wanted to experience that incredible temple structure and the monks and the religion behind it. China, go to the spiritual temples there, and meet local people, eat local food, you know, interact with people that may never have seen a Westerner and stuff. So you feel the individual, those are good experiences to have, you know. So I try to go to marketplaces, local markets, you know, so that you get to a good idea of their ways of life and go off the beaten track a little bit. Then I'll probably venture out to more touristy places just to see what they're like and stuff. But I do prefer the local environment of wherever I go. Mm. First time I'd ever been to China, landed it in Beijing, and was a little bit ignorant and was a bit surprised to see that there was nothing written in English anywhere. But why should it? But found it quite a good experience to try to navigate around from the airport into the center of Beijing by trying to learn symbols and the language, and that was a good test of me, but also I found what it was like to have the hospitality of complete strangers to help me and embrace that, and that was fantastic, you know. So it's always good to see local people, you know, and to experience that, because it's their home, it's their way of life, and that should be completely respected and get stuck in, you know.
And when you said you'd visited temples in Cambodia and China, what religions are those?
Mainly Buddhist temples in Cambodia. So it's same with Thailand. It's a lot of Buddhism. They call Thailand the land of smiles, because they're just sort of spiritually in touch with themselves, and that's a really, you just feel it, you know. I traveled around India a bit as well, and sort of Hindu temples and things like that, and again, it was just that sort of feeling that they're in touch with their inner self, and the worries that we have as Western cultures are just completely not relevant to them. The material things. I mean, don't be wrong, I enjoy the luxuries of life, and I buy a nice car and have a nice motorbike and wear nice watches and everything, and because I can afford it, and why not? But I think it's still important to be in touch with your sort of inner spiritual self, and to see that those material things are not what make you who you are, and you've got to be able to just release them, and so you know, give or take, it doesn't matter to me as long as I'm here, as long as I meet happy people, and as long as I try to have a happy existence. Happiness is the most important thing, you know. But the what I found in India and Southeast Asia is that that is the first thing that they look for, is happiness, and material objects don't matter. Unfortunately, due to mass capitalism, that's changing, but I think that's not a good thing, really. I respect those cultures that can find happiness from nothing, from just the environment around them, from nature, because I think if we lose that, then we lose purpose.
How old were you when you realized that you had this open-mindedness to spirituality?
It sort of happened in stages. One of the first experiences of travel was when I was about 24, and I'd never left this country by myself until then. And at the age of 24, I said, "Do you know what? I'd just come out of a marriage that broke down, and I said I need to press a reset button here in order to get myself back." So I booked a ticket to Australia and via Hong Kong, and just got on a plane and went. And it was a very big step for me, from living in a small town and to just going out there and seeing the big wide world. And I think from that point, from all the people I met along that journey, they, you know, were complete strangers, but were so friendly and embraced me and just got on with them and saw humanity as being as people, as being, you know, just this is what we're here, is enjoy this big community, be good to people, they'll be good to you, and I guess spirituality started from that point. I've always kind of had a connection with not religion as such, but religious kind of ideology, because I don't believe in one religion over another. I believe in certain messages that religion gives you. I think I see them as lessons, not as fact. They're kind of things to learn by, and that's why I listen to all religions and say, do you know what, I'll pick the best bit from that and the best bit from that, why not? If it teaches good, if it teaches happiness and embracing your fellow person, then why not? You know, it's all good. You know, but to add, I although I was brought up Christian, I don't see myself as Christian. I don't see myself as Catholic. I don't see myself as anything. I see myself as a person on this planet, and that in itself is a luxury. So I will embrace anybody that's going to be happy and nice to me. I'll be happy and nice back to them equally so, and live life as positively as I can, because that reverberation to other people is a good thing, you know. And part of what I do as a job, when I was operational and going and helping people, I mean, when you go into somebody's home and you put out a fire, or you remove some cooking that's burnt or whatever, and you see the change in their life that you've made by being there, or if you cut somebody out of a car and you've helped them, and you see the change, the difference in your positive act for them makes to their life, it hits home. And it, you know, why would you want to do anything other than that, you know? Then visiting countries in Southeast Asia and seeing how spiritually connected people are and how that is so closely linked to happiness, it just like, well, you know, it was an easy thing for me. It was, well, why would I want to be any different, really? So I guess it sort of came in stages through travel, through certain events in my life, losing both my parents and not allowing myself to go down this sinkhole of depression, because I've seen that in other people. And I try to help friends who have situations that are not good. And when you see them becoming happier and pulling out of depression, positivity is a good thing. And why would anybody want to gravitate towards anything other than that, you know?
Mm. What's your preferred method of consuming information? Are you a reader, or do you like to go to events and retreats, or do you listen to podcasts or documentaries? What do you tend to do?
I tend to listen more than read. But I choose my channels carefully. I am not a fan of mass media. I cannot stand it. I think it's just brainwashing. If you stick on the TV and you put on HTV News or things like that, or CNN or whatever, I think it's just designed to brainwash the masses, and I cannot stand it. So I'll be quite selective about what I read. I try to stick to things that I know are as factual as possible, and try to look into the background of those things to make sure they are factual. I was interviewed for the Guardian newspaper many years ago as part of my job, and I read that article about a week later when it was published, and I don't think that there was a single word that I'd said that was quoted in the article, which was meant to be about everything that I had said, and it was complete nonsense. And it was one of those things, from that point onwards I was like, well, you know, I never said any of those things, so how can they put my name to it or my photograph to it? And I was appalled, really. And so a lot of the stuff that I listen to are from members of the public that are right there, and they're telling their story live. Live clips are important. Journalists' points of views that are dubbed on afterwards mean nothing to me. I couldn't care less.
Yeah, it's a good distinction, that, isn't it? There's a big difference between listening to the actual original words that came from someone's mouth as opposed to a journalist reinterpretation, because they add their spin, they add their manipulation, they add their point of view, their bias to it, don't they?
Yeah, and that's it. That's exactly it. I'm not a fan of journalism. I think it's just make believe, really. You know, it's nonsense, and it's all done to persuade and to direct a point of view. Live broadcast is the thing for me.
Just out of curiosity, what was the story that they were dishonest about? What was it?
Well, essentially, it was about what it was like to be a firefighter and to work for a fire service and your daily sort of routine. So I told them what I did. I told them where I worked and what my daily routine was. An average day of one of the busiest stations in the Southwest, and it was just basically word for word completely different. It was a long time ago now, but it was one of the I've kept the excerpt somewhere, and I think a couple of years ago I even googled it and found it somewhere as well, and I just thought that was so bizarre. It was such a strange experience that I don't think many people on a day-to-day basis or even any time in their life have any interaction with journalists as such. You read a newspaper, you see it on TV. It's not until you have that interaction with a journalist for a news article of some sort that you really appreciate you know, their what they do for a living. And what they do for a living, in my perspective, I mean, everybody is entitled to their own opinion, but in my perspective, I just think that they are artists of spin, that's what they're designed to do, is just to put their particular broadcaster or newspaper's slant on it and their direction. Mm. You know, and in this day and age with Brexit and everything, you can see it happening all the time everywhere. I mean, you know, this country is in so much turmoil at the moment with opinions from this way to that way. Nobody knows which one's a lie or which one's the truth. And look at what it's doing for us. You know, absolutely nothing. But yeah, so that's why I tend to I don't think I've bought a newspaper for years and years and years. I just refuse to allow myself to spend money on media moguls and profit for them.
Did you ever end up in any dangerous situations on your travels, or did anything weird ever happen?
Well, yeah, actually, that's a good question, because due to my pure naivety and stupidity, I was on the last leg of a trip, which I did a load of diving and got my diving qualification in Thailand because it was cheap, and just finished doing a load of diving down in the islands, and was traveling back up to Bangkok to get my flight back to the UK. And I was staying on a traveler's street, which was a silly thing to do in Bangkok. And it was my last but one, my penultimate day there. And it was quite a long time ago. It was when the first generation of iPad had come out. So it was quite a new thing for somebody to have an iPad. And I was sitting in a cafe on my iPad, looking for local restaurants and local places to go and visit and things like that, and markets and things. And normally I would go back to my hotel room and put my iPad into the safe. And it just on this occasion, I just thought, I'm hungry, I'm just going to go for a walk. And it was getting late, so I thought, right, okay, I'll go down this road and I'll take this shortcut through this alleyway. And it took me to another road where I knew there was quite a few restaurants there. And went down this alleyway, and the next thing I know is metal bars being wrapped around the front of my head, and I'm being jostled to the ground, and I wake up 12 hours later, covered in blood from head to toe, with all of my possessions. That's it, they're gone. Yeah, that was pretty scary, because by that time I had about a day left to sort myself out before my flight was due, and my wallet had gone, my passport had gone, all my possessions had gone, everything. So it was a bit of a sobering moment then. And also this alleyway wasn't that far from the large river that winds its way through Bangkok. And so I felt at that point that I was a very lucky individual. And so I chose, because I think these are all about choices, I chose to take a positive spin on it and just say to myself, you are so lucky that you're alive today and you're alive to be able to get back to the hotel and sort yourself out. And that is what I did. And what was quite strange is I got back to the hotel, explained to the reception what had happened, and they gave me a spare key. They recognized who I was. Went up to the hotel and just laid on the bed, and I passed out again. And I think I woke up about 4 hours later to a knock on the door. And just as I was trying to open the door and get up and try and open the door, my passport was slid underneath the door. And I was like, well, that's just a bit strange. And I opened the door and there's nobody there, they'd gone. So I thought, right, well, that's a gift, because now I can get home. Because I was that out of it that I hadn't even thought about the passport issue. But there's my passport. Slid underneath the door. Yeah, and this is the other thing that really makes me believe in humanity, is that I had kept about the equivalent to £5 worth of money in the back of a book that was left in the hotel room. And so I then, with my passport and this you know, about £5 worth, I went downstairs and I thought, right, okay, I know that with my hotel key, I get a £10 deposit back from it. So I went out with this £5 note, and or the equivalent of £5 note, and went out and got some food because I hadn't eaten for a while. And I thought, right, okay, with the deposit return from the key, I can use that to buy a ticket to get to the airport. So it comes around to the time that I need to leave. I go downstairs with all my stuff packed up. I've had a shower. I felt a little bit better, refreshed. And then gave back my one key. And he said, you can't have your deposit back. And I said, why? And he said, well, because you've lost a key because it got stolen. And you were given two keys and you're only given one back. So we can't give you your deposit back. And I was like, well, that means I haven't got any money to get the coach back to the airport, which was quite a long way away. So I pleaded with the reception guy, and eventually he gave me the money back, right. which you know, it took a little bit of persuasion. Anyway, so I've got two cases. I go to the coach park, go to pay for my ticket, and the guy behind the ticket counter said, no, it's double price. And I said, why? And he said, because you got two bags. And at this point I'm going, oh my goodness, I've had enough now, you know. But at that point behind me, there was a German couple, and they saw that I was a little bit distressed. I had a plaster on my head where I'd been hit and stuff. And so I looked a bit of a stay, and they tapped me on the shoulder and said, hey, you know, we can see that you're having problems. We haven't got much money, but here's enough money for you to get your coach ticket. And they gave me enough money, and I'd never met these people in my life. And they gave me this money, and that helped me. That helped me enough to be able to get the ticket back to the airport and to have a small meal at the airport as well. And do you know what? It's that sort of kindness from complete strangers that really makes you understand that, do you know what, being good and being kind and being upbeat and positive, it really is the only way to be, you know. And it is a choice. It really is a choice, you know. I could have sat in that hotel room and let the whole world crash around me and just give up and just, and you know, but or been in that alleyway and felt the same. But you got to pick yourself up and dust yourself off and get on with it, and just, you know, tell yourself, be positive, be focused, get up and do what you got to do and move forward. You know, I've met so many people with depression. Depression is an illness. My brother, unfortunately, when he was young, he killed himself. And that was because of depression. He was unwell. Depression in those days was not treated correctly. We have to understand depression is an illness, but it is also about making choices as well, allowing people to help you, you know. Yeah, those experiences and things have helped me sort of enjoy life, really, you know.
I imagine as a firefighter, you must have seen a lot of stuff as well.
Oh, goodness me, yeah. I think within the first 4 years, I had to deal with that many fatalities that it was shocking, really, that I think... you know, before that, I'd never really experienced that side of life, and you know, the majority of people don't. But you talk to anybody in emergency services and they'll tell you what the reality of life is. And I think when you see that side of life and you see that amount of death and things like that, you just think, well, do you know what? Let's not waste it. Time is the most valuable commodity that we have. You can't earn it. You can't buy it. You can't. That's it. It's finite. So don't waste it. Because it could be snatched away from you in a millisecond, and that's that. So, you know, make the most of things whilst you're here. Mm. But the amount of not very nice situations that I've been involved in makes you appreciate life even more to a certain extent.
What proportion of emergencies that you get called out to are house fires? Like, is it? Do you have to deal with car crashes and other kinds of accidents as well?
Well, yeah. All fire services now are called fire and rescue services. Right. There's a lot more the fire service does than just go out and put fires out. One of the biggest things that we do is community engagement, and that's a very broad subject. So that could be going into people's properties to fit smoke alarms, engaging with members of the public to talk about community safety, going to schools to teach children about fire safety, visiting students to teach them about water awareness, where, you know, like in Bath or in Bristol, we have lots of areas that bar areas that have water right next to them. And we try to educate people about water safety. You know, if they've had a few to drink, make sure that they go get a taxi home and don't walk home by the waterside and things like that. And so there's such a broad spectrum of things that we do. And I try to sort of relate our job as being like a community safety officer to a certain extent. Although, you know, we do go into fires and we do wear breathing apparatus and we do put fires out, we also are a sort of a community safety person. Mm-hmm. You know, and I really enjoy going into people's homes and sitting down and talking to them about their home safety and making sure their electrical sockets are safe and they're not overloading things and making sure their smoke alarm works. Because at the end of the day, if they haven't cleaned it or changed the battery, it's useless. But that smoke alarm ultimately could save their life. For something that provided from us to people that really need it, is free. Or if you want to go down to B&Q or whatever and buy one for £15 or whatever, then, you know, that £15 could save your life. We also do technical rope rescues, so we abseil off of cliffs to rescue people, climbers and things like that, or we do water safety, so we have boats that would go out and rescue somebody in the docks and things, and we help the ambulance service gain access into properties if there's an elderly person that's fallen behind a door and the ambulance service can't get in, then we'll go and assist the ambulance with that sort of thing. So it's a really broad spectrum of things that the fire service does, but the end and most important thing is about safety. We are there to make our communities safer, and that is our sole purpose, is making our communities safer. I've always said from the day I started that job, it was the best thing that I could ever do. I wouldn't want to do anything else. Mm. You know, it's making our community safer. It gives you such a buzz. Mm. And when you talk to people, elderly people who don't get out much and stuff, but you give a half an hour of your time to them and have a good old chat over a cup of tea and try and bring home this safety message, Or whatever community that you're going into, whatever diverse community that you're visiting, because it doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, what background you've got. I enjoy going and visiting anybody, and quite rightly so. We're all here together, but you get a buzz from knowing that you're potentially making that person's life a little bit safer and that community a little bit safer, and that's a good thing.
How many fire and rescue people are there in the UK?
Oh, crikey. Wow, that's a good question. I think it's tens of thousands.
Mm.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, a lot.
And how many years have you been doing it?
So I've been doing it, I think, around about 16 years, 16 coming on to 17 years. And for the past nearly 3 years, I've been working in an office environment, so my role has changed quite a lot. Nevertheless, it's still about safety. It's still about passing a message on and making safety awareness sort of the key. So a part of what I do is gather information from fire crews as to, you know, how they have responded to an incident, and if there's anything that they could do better, if there's anything that we can change nationally. So if something has come up that it was seen to be safety critical, that we could change as a service to make those firefighters' lives safer, I identify that and then pass that information on to services around the country. Pardon me. So that's part of my role at the moment, and I developed an IT system to do that.
Right.
Sorry, Ben.
That's all right.
I'm just going to grab a glass of water a minute.
That's all right.
Sorry.
That's all right. You okay?
Yeah.
Have construction methods and building regulations made buildings safer and less vulnerable to fire as time's gone on?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, the construction industry and everything, all types of modern regulation are all designed, actually, with safety in mind. So as the regulations get stricter and building materials get more advanced, all of those things are essentially designed around safety. And, there is obviously cost implications involved. And manufacturers look at cost implications, but essentially, all of our legislation that gets put into place nowadays, the main drive is around safety. So building materials and building supplies and construction nowadays, it is an awful lot safer than it was 20, 30 years ago. I remember, my father, I've seen pictures of him working on the side of steel girders up high buildings and things without any harnesses on and all that sort of stuff. And you think, wow, the difference now. I mean, you wouldn't be allowed to enter a building site nowadays without high vis on, without hard hat, and you wouldn't be able to go up a building without the correct harnesses and everything. And so building construction, houses are a lot safer. The problems you get is when certain construction companies try to cut corners, construction companies try to buy materials that aren't fit for purpose, and they try to avoid legislation because they're trying to cut corners. But there's so many different inspectors around nowadays that that's a you know, very far and few between. But you are always going to get situations where the human element creates issues. You know, you only have to look at Grenfell for that.
I was going to ask you about that. Yeah, what was your point of view on that?
Well, that is down to money. You know, every single firefighter that went into that building should be given a medal. You know, and all of the press around about the fire service response, the dispatches program, and all that sort of thing. I mean, they should all be disgraced, really, because all those firefighters that went into that building, you know, they were putting themselves into incredibly dangerous situations, and they should all get medals. You know, the people that fought for Grenfell, the planning officers and the council that bought the cladding, and you know, the problem with the tower itself is that it shouldn't have been refurbished. It should have been demolished and rebuilt, because the building wasn't fit for purpose in the first place. You had one central stairwell, so there was only one only one access and egress. So they were trying to refurb a building that wasn't really fit for modern purpose anyway. And also a local borough council that was cutting corners with the products they were using.
So how did the media coverage portray the firefighters? I don't really remember what happened.
Well, I don't think it was they tried to say that that the fire service should have told people to evacuate the property sooner. There's two problems with that, and that's our message in a high-rise block of flats is to stay in your flat. And the reason why that is the case is because historically, high-rises, each flat is like a concrete block, right? It's like a concrete container. Yeah. So it has no connection to the flat next door. It's your property your flat that you live in is a concrete box. Yeah. There's no way that any fire can get from your property to the property next door just because of the construction. Mm. Now, that is the case and is still the case in most properties, most high rises around the UK. So if Joe Bloggs has got a fire in their flat next door, you can quite happily stay in your flat and close your door, stay there, and you'll be safe. Now, the problem with Grenfell is obviously the cladding. Mm. So the cladding meant that theory of staying in your flat was completely blown away, because the fire wasn't spreading internally at all. It was spreading via the cladding, which was outside, and so it was spreading up the side of the building and then going to through each window space. Mm. So the whole idea of staying in your property meant nothing then, because you weren't safe. Mm. Now, the other issue that they had in Grenfell is that there was only one way in and out of the building through a stairwell that went through the center of the building. So even if after a certain point, even if you wanted to get out of that flat and get out of that block of flats, you would have probably still not made it, because the stairwell was compromised with toxic smoke anyway. Mm. So if you're on level 10, and by this time the fire's been going for a couple of hours and spread up the side, and you want to get out of your flat because you think the best thing to do is to evacuate rather than stay still, which is what the fire service's advice was. Mm. If you want to get out of your flat because you realize that the fire's spreading up the side, if you go out your front door, you get to the stairwell is going to be filled with smoke. You wouldn't make it down two flights of stairs before you're dead anyway. Mm. So it was a catch 22. Mm. And so the only thing that people could do was wait for firefighters to knock on your door. Then you get given, you know, help with breathing apparatus, and then they take you down. Mm. And that's what firefighters were doing. Mm. But there's only so many firefighters, and there's only so many times that they can go up through a burning flight of stairs, mm. Or through burning building, before they become absolutely exhausted. Now, those firefighters, most of them went into that building and out again, back into that building and out again, back into that building and out again, several times, with complete exhaustion, to try and help people. Mm. Now, you know, they were putting their lives on the line to do that. Mm. And I think the media should be disgraced with themselves for saying anything adverse against those firefighters. Now, it's not the fault of the fire service. It's not the fault of the firefighters. It's the fault of the local planning officers and the local council to allow that situation to have got to that point in the first place.
Mm, I see. So the default advice in a block of flats is for people to stay in their thing, but like you said, that didn't work because the fire came up the cladding up the outside.
That's right. And so because there was only one way in and out of that property, that neither would have worked. Mm. You know, and that's the thing. The only thing that, I guess, even if you had sprinklers within every property, which are now being retrofitted across the country to all high-rise blocks of flats, even if you had sprinklers in your property, if that fire is raging up through the cladding on the outside of the building, sprinklers wouldn't have made much of a difference either, to be honest.
So presumably a tower block is the worst for a fire, is it, from a fire point of view?
Yeah, I mean, especially the higher you go up a tower block, because of the time it takes to set up and stage the situation to fight the fire. Mm. So all tower blocks have a system where you can plug your hoses in at the bottom, prime the building with water, and then when you get to the floor that you want, you plug another set of hoses into an outlet, and then that gives you the ability to use hose from that floor to any flat.
Oh, I see. That's built in.
That's built into all high rises over a certain number of floors. Mm. Now, but to set that up takes time. And you know, if you've ever seen any footage of how quickly fires develop and spread, it doesn't give much time, and so that's why they're saying sprinklers are the safer option in high rises. Mm. You know, there's obviously a cost for that, but it, you know, it's ultimately safer. I mean, you know, where I live, I live in like a house, but I make sure when I leave my house, all of my plug sockets are turned off. I never go to sleep with my mobile phone charging. I'll never, ever go to sleep with a tumble dryer on. I'll never leave the house with a tumble dryer on. And any electrical items, I'll always switch off at the wall.
Do they cause a lot of fires, do they?
Tumble dryers aren't great. I'd never leave one unattended. Absolutely not. You know, any appliance like that, I'd never leave unattended. I certainly wouldn't go to sleep with anything like that on. Mobile phone chargers are quite bad. There are countless occurrences across the country of where people have gone to sleep with their phone charging, and then that's caused a fire. Whether or not it's because the charger was bought from a market and it's a dodgy import or whatever, but it's just, you know, charge it whilst you're watching telly before you go to bed or something. You know, don't do it whilst you're asleep. I mean, you know, I have I bought a CO2 fire extinguisher for my house, and I keep it in the kitchen. It costs £25, and you know, I know if something happened, I'll just like use that and then get out. Our advice from the fire service is, if there's a fire in your house, get out, stay out, call the fire service. Don't go back in to try and do anything. Just get out, stay out, call the fire service. It's as simple as that, you know. And if you are stuck upstairs in a room, then close the door, put stuff down at the bottom of the door so smoke can't get through, open your window and call the fire service, you know. That's the advice. It's never really going to be the fire that kills you anyway. It will always be the smoke. And that's why we have smoke alarms, and that's why they're so sensitive. So if the smoke alarm goes off when you're cooking, don't take the battery out. Just press the reset button. It hushes the alarm for a couple of minutes, but it's still active. And that's the advice I give, you know.
What's the biggest fire you've ever been called to?
Wow. Okay. Well, the building's not there anymore. There's been quite a few, but one of the memorable ones for me was a building next to the SS Great Britain. It was an old furniture factory. It was derelict. It'd been used for years for hosting illegal raves and everything. We did an inspection there years ago, and the lower ground floor was covered in sawdust that was like about a foot or two deep. And then about a month later, there was a fire there, and I remember going into one of these concrete stairwells to fight this fire, and I had the largest hose that you can have, and I was firing this hose at this fire, and it wasn't even touching it. And the noise, this fire coming up this stairwell was like coming out of a jet engine. It was incredible, and that was pretty ferocious, to be honest.
Is that because the flow of air was sort of like fueling the flames? Or
yeah, the sawdust, the flow of air, the fact that it was so big, and it was just, you know, but we were worried, although the building was derelict, we were worried that people might have been sleeping in there and stuff like that. So we still had to attack it. That was pretty ferocious. But some of the fires, it's not about the size, it's almost about the confinement. I've been into a house fire where you're going into rooms that are completely, they're glowing orange, you know, and the whole room is engulfed in fire. I remember being in one where we went to one room to tackle a blaze, and when we came out of that, the fire had gone up behind us through a staircase, and there was a boiler up on a wall that had completely melted behind us. And we were like, well, okay, that was pretty lucky that we weren't in the pathway of that. But those things can be they cause a lot of adrenaline rushes, to be fair, but you have to remain professional and always think about your training and always think about safety, and
if you've been in the fire service for, I think you said 17 years, what did you do before that?
I ran my own business. So I left college as a designer, graphic designer. Worked in a printing company, screen printing company, for many years. I taught myself how to program industrial embroidery machines to put logos onto shirts and things like that. I was unhappy where I was working, so I decided to leave and set up my own business. Doing the same sort of thing. Being that I've got quite a creative mind, I never settled with doing one thing, so I taught myself how to do web design, computer programming, sign writing, you name it, building websites, I try to do it, and was quite successful, to be honest. And I did that for a few years, and the business was running really well. But I just felt, you know, whereas before I had one boss, when I was working for myself, I've now got a million. And at that time, they were all trying to crush me for price. And it was, competition was just a bit cruel. And I just thought, this isn't for me anymore. I want to do something that's going to be better than this, something that's giving back. And a friend of mine at the time had joined the fire service. He'd been in it for a couple of years, and I was chatting to him, and he said, "Well, just there's a recruitment day for the fire service. Go for it." And I went for it. And then 9 months later, I managed to sell my business the day before I joined the training school, and started training school and never looked back. Mm. It was the best thing I could ever have done. I still have a passion for business. So I still think about buying and selling on my days off. I still think about making money, and but making money to do good things, to go out and enjoy myself, to travel and stuff like that. So I still sort of, that's why I recycle and upcycle old things and give them new lease of life. And so at the moment, I'm into Art Deco and Art Deco lighting and stuff. And I also like a bit of property as well. So myself and my brother have a property that we rent out and things. And so there's always that side of me, because my parents were ran companies, and so that's kind of in me to do that as well. And I enjoy that. And I also love photography. So I fly drones. I fly photographic videography drones, and I've got a little business that does that, as and when I can be bothered, you know.
Oh, I see. Right.
Yeah. But property's interesting. I watched your one of your podcasts about a chap in Bristol. Mm. Has quite a few properties, and I'm really interested in that. Being an ethical landlord is the direction that I prefer. I think there's a lot of greedy landlords out there, and those are the ones that probably, in my mind, end up being the unsuccessful ones, because they see profit and money before the actual tenant, which in this day and age I don't think is the right thing.
Do you have plans to do more?
I've thought about it. I think with the current changes in tax law looming, I think that might be more and more difficult. And, you know, it's about being satisfied with your lot. I think sometimes people lose sight of why they started it in the first place. If you've got one or two properties and that's bringing you an income that you can live on, and you're satisfied and you're not just comfortable but more than comfortable, then is it worth getting stressed and stuff about making more money? And people get lost in that, and I've seen people suffer for that, and then they've lost sight as to why they did it in the first place. So I'm very cautious about work-life balance and enjoying what you do. Mm-hmm. Because you can spend your life hunting every last penny, and then look back and think, well, you know, why did I do that? What have I missed in the meantime? If I can get in my car, get on my motorbike on the weekend and not be answerable to anybody, but also be able to afford to do what I want, then that's it. That's good enough for me.
And what's your plans for the future then, Sean?
Hopefully I'll get work hard with what I'm doing. Want to get promoted. Want to get to more of a senior position in what I'm doing, so that I can make more of a difference in what I do at work. As far as personal life, I'd really quite like to move out of Bristol. I'd quite like to find somewhere a little bit more rural. Where I live at the moment, it satisfies me and it serves a purpose for the time being. But it'd be nice to live somewhere a bit more rural. And to be honest, I still do quite like my upcycling that I that I do. I restored a couple of pinball machines last year. It was really quite, that was really rewarding and good fun as well. So I just quite carry on doing that sort of thing, to be honest. The fire service does have a good pension scheme, even though we've had quite a lot of it taken away from us in the not too distant past. It's still not that bad. There are possible changes that have recently come about by a legal case that may mean that we get some of our pension back. When I joined the fire service, I was told that I could retire at 50. 5 years later, they changed that to say, nope, you're not going to retire until you're 55. And they took away a bit of our lump sum bit that you'd get at the end of it. Bearing in mind that this is money that we've paid in. You know, we're not being given this. This is money that we've paid in out of our wages, our earnings. And then 5 years after that, they said, nope, you're not going to retire at 55. You have to retire at 60. And we're going to take you more money out of your pension that you've put in. And so they sort of, the government stole that off of us. So, you know, normally I'd probably only have 2 years left before I retire, but now I've got 12 years left before I retire. So that's a big difference.
Right.
So I think anybody's going to struggle to retain being a firefighter until they're 60. I mean, can you imagine somebody at 58, 59, 60 running into a burning building to rescue somebody?
Yeah.
It's just not going to happen, is it?
It's not ideal.
You know, but the government know that. And they don't want people to stay that long in the fire service. They want you to retire early so that they don't have to pay you as much. So they've done it. You know, it's some actuary somewhere has crunched the numbers, looked at the statistics, and thought, right, well, we'll just put that in place because we know we're gonna get X amount of money back from it. You know.
Yeah, they're just moving numbers around, aren't they? Trying to save money.
Yeah. And there are people that, you know, sit in offices doing that, and they have no connection with people, so that they're able to do that. That's why, you know, they get paid to do that sort of thing. There's no emotion there. But a lot of people that get affected by it.
Well, that's been a fascinating conversation.
I've just rabbited on for quite a while, haven't I?
Well, yeah, but that's the idea, you know. Yeah, it's great to hear your life experiences and all of that. So thank you.
Yeah. That's all right, Ben. No problem at all.
Have you got any final words before we wrap up?
Well, I guess for me, whatever you do, you know, I said it earlier in that we've all got a set amount of time on this planet. Some have got less than others, and time is the most valuable thing in your life. Try not to waste it on negativity. If you can help somebody, help them. If you see somebody struggling and you have the skills to make their life better, then share those skills with them. You know, just do things that make you happy, as long as they don't make somebody else unhappy. You know, try not to affect anybody else's life adversely along the way, and just live it as best as you can, you know.
Yeah.
So that's pretty much it, really. I think that's about as spiritual as you're going to get.
Well, I don't think anybody can argue with that. So
yeah.
All right then, mate. Thanks very much. Great talking to you.
Okay, Ben.
Yeah,
thank you.
I'll come and visit at some point next time I'm over in Bristol.
That'd be great.
All right, okay. I'll drop you a message. Right.
Brilliant. Thanks, Ben.
Cheers. Sean. Bye.